By the way, did you know that stress balls can break? Like, so this is like,
what's inside? I've always wondered, is there stress in there?
Stress kitten. Look. See?
You know you are stressed when you break your stress ball.
Isn't that weird? So like, I'm like, ew, this is going to be so gross. But I haven't even had it that long. What's but I'm like, that's, it's so like creepy and weird, you know,
you that
it
would like. We know you reach maximum stress when you break your stress ball.
I have a feeling
there are a lot of broken stress balls running around.
By the way, I'm not even that strong. Okay. So hi everyone. I'm Stefanie Marrone. Welcome to Legal Marketing Coffee Talk. This is my co-host,
Rob Cates.
Thank you, Rob. You have perfect lighting. And if anyone wants to talk to Rob about how he got that lighting, I look blotchy and dark and terrible. Also, we are going to be able to mark the amount of time that we've been in quarantine by my roots. So we should start doing that. I'm also got a calendar that I'm doing like X's
on. On her wall. She's making little marks on her
wall.
Yeah,
on my wall. Rob, can I show you another birthday gift that someone sent me, which I love?
Yeah.
Look at this.
Is that Yoda Jr.? Baby Yoda?
Yeah, well, the artist formerly known as Baby Yoda, really the Mandalorian, but how cool is that, right?
Very cool.
Yes. So anyway, thank you to my friend Connie for sending that to me. Cool. So Rob, what do we have on tap today?
So we have a guest, but first I just want to announce our prize for the week. We are giving away one of these handy. It's a phone holder. You can put your cell phone in there like that and use it for Zoom calls. It'll hold your phone up for Zoom calls or steady your phone video. And I just lost Stefanie. There we go. She's back. To win that, all you have to do is make a comment in the comment field anywhere in the video, whether you're watching it live or recorded later. And everybody that puts in a comment will enter them into a drawing for the phone.
And make the comments insightful and flattering towards us.
We'll settle for hello.
Okay.
So, anyway, so our guest for today?
Mm-hmm.
Our guest today is Iris J. Jones. She's the Chief Business Development and Marketing Officer at McNees, Wallace, and Nurick in Harrisburg, PA. She's a member of the State Bar of Texas and was the co-chair of the first LMA Diversity and Inclusion Task Force and has served as a speaker at numerous LMA annual and regional programs. Let's welcome Iris.
Hey,
good
Iris.
Good guys.
Hi.
How are you?
How are you?
Thank you for getting dressed up for us.
Do we have Stefanie back?
Yeah, I'm here.
Can't you hear Steph? Folks, we seem to be having some technical difficulties. Iris cannot hear Stefanie. Stefanie, pop in. Let me try this first. See if that helps. Now, can you guys hear each other?
Can you hear me?
Hi, Steph.
There we go.
Okay, cool. How are you? Thank you for getting dressed up for us today. Really? No, she can't hear me?
Can't hear you.
All right.
Stephanie's going to log out real quick. She'll be right back.
I wonder why that's happening.
Thanks.
Welcome to the exciting world of live video. So she'll be back any second now. And there's her feed.
Hi.
Hi, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay,
we're back.
We're back. Sorry about that, guys. Iris, thank you for getting dressed up for us today.
I'm excited about wearing a jacket. I haven't had a jacket on, it seems like, in 3 months. Only been a month. So
I saw this meme that you'll find amusing. It says, my shoes think I'm dead, which I think is really interesting. Like, I haven't worn anything other than, like, shoes that are like flats to walk my dog, flip-flops or sneakers. So I'm afraid I'm not gonna be able to get into any of my shoes when this is all over. We'll have to see. So Iris, where are you coming? I'm in New York City. Rob is in Philly, outside of Philly.
I'm not too far from Rob. I'm in Harrisburg, PA, the state capital of Pennsylvania.
We're practically neighbors.
Where folks are protesting so they can go back to work. I think you probably saw some national news.
And that's going to keep us out of work even longer when they do that. So
there, I wasn't one of the protesters. I'm staying sheltered in, just like the governor said.
Yeah. How have things been for you since the sheltering?
Well, the first few weeks, it wasn't bad. You know, I caught up on a lot of things around the house, you know, did a little bit of prep work for my garden and things of that nature. I'm lucky. I'm on an acre of land and have a beautiful view, and thank God it's spring. So I'm coping quite well. Just finding things to do. My flower beds have never been cleaner and neater. And I sneak off to the hardware store and I order online plants and seeds. And I'm watching a lot of things grow that I would have never thought about before.
That's a great thing to do. It also, to me, symbolizes like rebirth and growth. And yes. To be able to say, you know, I planted this tree or this plant or whatever it is during this time, that's great. And so, yeah, I know things in New York, like the cherry blossoms are just booming and they're gorgeous. And we take
for granted. Flowers, or are you planting vegetables too?
I'm doing flowers. I did daffodils, irises, of course.
Have to have irises.
Looks great. Now it's time for the other. The azaleas are in. And the seeds, I'm actually going to try my hand at sunflower seeds. I found a few good sunny spots, and I'm going to just try my hand at that. And also, I'm working on seeding some fresh basil and also some rosemary seeds. Normally, I buy the rosemary plants, but I'm going to do it from seeds now. And I've gotten a little crazy because I took my avocado seed and I put the toothpicks in it, and it's in the window and it's growing this little root. So I'm going to try my hand at a little avocado. So you know I've got a lot of time on my hands in the evenings and weekends.
I mean, it's better than watching Tiger King, in my opinion, to do those sorts of things. I bought all of these organizers. Rob doesn't know this. I went to the container store, and I got these cabinet organizers to organize, and refrigerator organizers. So like you can create two shelves in one shelf, and then all of these like things for your refrigerator to make things easier to find. So I am so excited to do this this weekend. That's what I'm going to be doing, guys. That's the quarantine life. And we're lucky enough to be healthy enough to plant, to do these things. So, you know, I don't take that for granted with so many people being ill.
Right.
So Iris, we wanted to talk to you a little bit about, you know, how you've been doing, what's going on at work, how marketers could be more relevant during this crisis, and get to know you a little bit better. So does that sound good? And then we'll have Rob come back and we will reveal our coffee cups, although I kind of saw yours and I like it. So we'll go back to yours at the end.
So I'm going to head out. Talk amongst yourselves.
Thanks, Rob.
All right. So first of all, tell me, is your firm publishing a ton of content when it comes to COVID, and what have you been finding in terms of how it's doing and what's going on with your content? How's your team doing? How's managing a team remotely? How are your lawyers doing? I'm saying I broke my stress ball because I've been using it so much and I'm afraid it's going to explode. So I'm actually not going to touch it.
What we've done, you've asked a lot of questions. What we've done, Stephanie, is like everybody else is doing. We're managing to take those digital methodologies to a whole new level. And we are working very hard not to be tone deaf at any point in time. I mean, we're all about making money. It is a business, you know, we're not nonprofits, and we have to think about that, you know, sustaining the business, if you will. However, we don't want to be tone deaf to our clients and to our prospects and to the community. And we are huge in our communities around the state of Pennsylvania, Ohio, and D.C. and Frederick, Maryland. And we don't want people to perceive us as money grubbing during this kind of crisis. I mean, we are truly in a crisis. So what we are spending a lot of time on is doing as much as we can in terms of pro bono. We've expanded our pro bono program, which I'm very proud of.
Yeah.
Also worked very hard to do as much as we can in the community to serve our community, not just small businesses, but also individuals in the community.
How? Tell us about that.
Well, in terms of helping them navigate all of the new legislation, for example, we have McNees Strategies Strategic Solutions Group, MSSG, and we are, you know, we have a lobby that's an lobbying arm, among other things, and we have helped a lot of small businesses that are literally on the brink of losing their business and not surviving this. But helping them navigate the loan packages, the payroll protection plan, loan packages, et cetera, for survival. So, and a lot of that work is being done on a volunteer basis. We are in our community in that way. My team and I are looking for ways to be relevant to our attorneys because, as we all very well know, most of us, I can't speak for all law firms, but most of us are truly looking for ways to not only remain relevant, working for ways to sustain our business, but also looking for ways in which we can communicate and how we can help each other internally as well. So instead of us doing the day-to-day marketing and BD strategy, we're looking at ways in which we can better serve our community. Let me tell you what my team and I have been doing. Let's be honest. We're not as busy as we are when we're fully focused and in the office.
Right.
So what we've been doing is we've been going through the website, and we are navigating to see some of those attorneys who perhaps maybe haven't published in a while. We had new hires. We had two new attorneys come in within 30 days prior to the shutdown.
Mm.
So they must be, I can only imagine, if I was an attorney, joined a firm, and then we had a shutdown within 30 days, how I might be flopping around a little bit like a fish out of water, trying to find my way and navigate through to make sure I was relevant, my profile was raised, and also matched with the firm that I just joined. So we've been reaching out one-on-one with folks and working with them on a very individualized basis. Now, we talk about this stuff all the time, but in terms of reality, we just don't have time to do that one-on-one care. And I'm not able to do it for everybody. Well, we started with the newbies because we know they need help. So the newbies, they now have a path, if you will. We work with the practice group leaders, of course, coordinating all of this, but one of them is a practice group leader. We brought on a new guy who is in charge of our gaming practice. So we've been helping him. He's being interviewed by the CCBJA, the Corporate Counsel Business Journal, and he will be published in that issue, this upcoming issue. We think that's important for people to feel like there's somebody there that has their back, providing the services that we wish we had the opportunity to do. First of all, I would recommend if you do something along those lines, and you probably some of you probably are, that you would take the bio of that individual, read it, and read all of the articles that they have written, and go on the LinkedIn profile of that person and learn as much about them and their past as possible. So when you make recommendations to them, you're not just calling up going, hey, what can I do for you? You have certain recommendations, certain strategies that you want to present to them so that you are giving them value, not just support and service. It's quite important, but you want to give them value and you want it to be customized and tailored to their practice, to their background, to their skill set. And they have been very grateful. And I've never had anyone say, nah, I don't want to do that, or no, I'm not interested. Now, right. When you put out a general email and say, here's some thought leadership ideas, webinars, perhaps a blog post, some mm-hmm. of them, that it's all great, but it's sent out to the masses. But when you call someone up or reach out to someone and you have a customized idea, it's a starting point and a talking point, and it leads to real action.
I mean, I can't agree with you more. The one-on-one attention. I would give you an example. My neck of the woods. Yesterday, I did a Zoom LinkedIn bio refresh with one of my clients, one of the lawyers at one of my clients. And so he's like, let's share your screen. I said, no, let's share your screen. We're going to go through your profile and we're going to make the changes on screen.
Nice.
Because he wanted me to do it. And I said, no, let's do it together. So it was the one-on-one attention. But I also agree with you. Great point on, I read his bio before. I looked at his LinkedIn profile before. I came with bullets of things I wanted to do. and things I would suggest. And my advice was very targeted and it was very personal. So, you know, it seems like such a basic to read their, look at their past speaking engagements and articles, but it's, and look at their LinkedIn profile, but it's so important before you meet with them. So I would recommend doing this sort of like one-on-one thing, like I'm suggesting, and offer value with their LinkedIn profiles and that sort of thing. I mean, again, you had mentioned wanting to be relevant and helpful and proving value. That's exactly the way that I would recommend doing that. And there's a lot more we could do. You have any other thoughts on that?
I just wanted to add one other point. I know oftentimes, you know, I talk to my colleagues, you know, they'll say, well, I'm reluctant to ask questions or make suggestions to some of the more challenging partners. You know, I don't want them to think I'm stupid or uninformed. You know, if you don't, they're going to wonder, what are you here for? You know, what is your value? But I'm not afraid to make a mistake or to ask a question that may not be right on point. I reached out to our estate planning group and it said, you know, we have to be very cautious about how we present this. We don't want to tell people, hey, you might die from COVID-19, so you better get a will. We don't want to be crass and approach something like that. But in terms of providing a service to our community and making sure people are, you know, so we approached it of, you know, with tips and tools about updating your power of attorney, if you have one, updating your living will, et cetera. And so these are reminders that I'm really happy to have myself as a person who hasn't updated her will in quite a while. So when I approached the head of estate planning, I said, these are some of the things I've been thinking about for myself. What do you think about us hosting a webinar to remind folks out there, our clients and folks who have been frequent attendees of our seminars, what do you think about doing something along those lines? And people, they had so many questions post-webinar. We stayed on, it was through GoToWebinar, and we had more questions almost than the content. But people want to know and they want to be prepared. So during this time, we're all thinking introspectively about what we need, what we haven't done, what we need to do, and what we wish we had have done while we have this time at home sheltered in. Because we will be back to work and we will be back out there buzzing along, and we'll think about the time that we spent watching Netflix or, you know, reading, you know, magazines. Nothing's wrong with Netflix, I watch, and nothing's wrong with magazines and books. I'm an avid reader, but I can tell you that we will think about this time and say, I spent a lot of time doing good things and I wasted a lot of time doing things I wish I had.
I couldn't agree with you more. And it's never been more important to show value for yourself, as we are, you know, I love when Jennifer Johnson says we're revenue enablers. And I think that that is so true, but you know, we're not billable for the most part, and we're considered an overhead cost. And so we have to prove our value and we've got to pivot. So I was using the word pivot a lot today in a presentation that I did earlier this morning, you know, and being empathetic and really just understanding that it's not business as usual and that we can help and provide value. But, you know, I think, Iris, there's a lot of people who feel nervous, on edge, like maybe I'll lose my job, maybe my salary will be cut, maybe I'll be furloughed. And so that's why they're over producing and helping. Like there's a lot of firms producing a ton of content and a lot of lawyers maybe who aren't as busy. So I just think it's an interesting, there's like a happy medium between the two in terms of don't seem too over eager and do too much. And then, you know, just do the right amount. So anyway, those are my two cents on that. So what
another point I wanted to make, and yeah, you know, we should be equipped and we should be prepared with recommendations, but we should also be good listeners during this time.
Yeah.
They have needs that they've been too busy to ask us to fulfill for them. So we also have to listen. I just wanted to throw that out because sometimes we're so ready to run in with the recommendation and we think this is good for you, take this medicine, but it also is very important for us to hear what they want and what they need.
Couldn't agree with you more. Are you guys starting to think about what the world will look like in terms of at your firm after the regulations are lifted and some of us go back to work?
Yes, we are. Actually, I'm on the COVID-19 task force and we are actually meeting this afternoon by GoToMeeting, and we'll be talking about, we're not, you know, the Pennsylvania's not open yet, but we're talking about what we need to have in place, what equipment we need to have available, what kind of system we'll have, will it be a rotational Will we give the folks the option of continuing to work from home for a bit? I know some people have childcare issues, and they really aren't prepared to just leave their children at home and can't do that. So they must, you know, continue the remote work. And so that's all being taken into consideration. I have to, you know, to give it to my chair for our firm. He is planning well ahead of time. So we will make sure that we have the masks, our facial masks available, our hand sanitizers, everything in place, and how we will actually roll the staff back into place. And it's really hard because everybody's anxious because we don't know when, you know, and all that uncertainty, which causes a lot of anxiety. But we will be back, and we have to think in terms of planting those seeds like corn. You know, you don't grow corn overnight. You plant the seeds in the ground, and the next day there's those corn stalks. It takes time. So all of the things that we, with business development and marketing techniques and activities, we're growing that corn, and we're thinking very strategically, and we're also being, we don't want to be tone deaf, but we're being very smart about the fact that at some point in the near future, not sure when, but we will be back in full force, and we will have wished that we planted those corn seeds.
Yeah. I mean, I love that you're very into gardening, and so all your analogies have to do with plants and vegetables. Right. It really helps me, especially for the person with the black thumb. Like, I actually do get it. If you have any tips on how to not kill an orchid, I would very much appreciate those, because I kill all orchids and all plants, and that's why I own zero of those. Have you been keeping sane, like, personally? Like you said, obviously gardening, but what has helped you in terms of just maintaining, you know, balancing your life right now and not, you know, working from home is an adjustment, I think, for all of us.
Well, the first few days, I never worked from home, you know, unless I had a repair person coming in to fix something for a couple hours, then I'd zip right back to the office. I have a variety, I believe in variety and making sure that you mix it up. And even for those folks who are in apartments, have various stations and move around. You know, I was confined to my kitchen island because I had windows. I could see out at the bird feeder. You know, I could get to the refrigerator quickly. You know, I had all this access, right, in open space. And I thought after a few days, I'm really getting tired of sitting on this bar stool. I really need to change my location. So on those really warm days that were 70, I would give myself an hour outside on the deck. And I have a Weimaraner, and he needs lots of exercise. So I have to walk him at least four times a day. It's usually 6 in the morning, right before 8, and then noon, and then 5 o'clock. And sometimes I have to get right back on it, but I have to make sure that he gets his exercise. So it forces me to get out and get my exercise as well. So I would say for those folks who are confined, you know, go ahead and order those seeds online and start yourself a little garden with just a small bag of dirt and maybe a couple of planters.
Yeah.
And you can watch that grow. That's exciting. It's stimulating. If you are into art or music, even if you just listen to music, you know, change your music up a little bit. Read those books that you've been putting off. We all have some books on our shelves that we haven't read, but we've been getting around to it for some time. So just make those lists of things that you've always wanted to do, and you know you'll be mad at yourself if you don't do it during this time that you have.
And make sure that, yeah.
Occasionally, and when I go to the grocery store, even with my mask on, I put a little makeup on so I don't frighten the cashier. You know, it's kind of fun to say, okay, I care enough about myself to comb my hair today, you know, or take a shower. Yeah. Put on shoes when you have meetings because it makes you feel more, some people say it makes them feel like they're more in the office or more in tune in terms of professionalism. Just like today, I was dying to wear my new jacket and I haven't been able to wear it, so I thought I'd put it on for this show. So it's going right off as soon as
Yeah, I know. But, you know, I agree with you. I mean, this forces me to, like, look at least somewhat decent every day. Like, I do take a shower and I have to blow dry my hair. But the first couple of weeks, like, I was like, okay, I don't have to do anything. I don't have to put any makeup on. You can't tell that I'm wearing sweatpants or leggings on the bottom, like most newscasters. It just doesn't matter. But I agree with you. It's sort of like, you know, also we're on Zoom calls or GoToMeeting or video conference, whatever it is. You do want to make sure you look, you know, kept up. And I do see, so funny, I see so many men with whom I work, all of a sudden I'm like, who is that? And they've got longer hair and beards, you know, so I think it's just interesting. And I'm also appreciating peeling back the curtain on people's personal lives. Like, I didn't know you had a Weimaraner. Like, I have a French bulldog who is the laziest dog in the world, but I still have to walk him several times a day. And I agree with you, walking your pet gets you out of the house. It gets you active and it's good for you. Even if I have to wear a mask while I'm walking my dog, because I live in New York City. So it's just good stuff. Iris, in terms of what you've been like, have you been cooking? Have you been ordering in? Are you a good cook? Like, tell us about. And
I am a cook, and I, you know, I'm from the old school, and I'm very proud of being a baby boomer. And I'm also one of 9 children. So I would always like to help my mom as the oldest daughter in the family, daughter brothers, but all as the oldest daughter, I'd like to cook for my entire family. I thought it was really exciting. Back then we peeled potatoes. We did not do the instant, and we didn't use minute rice. We did the real thing, the long grain rice. So I am kind of into, you know, cooking and making special dishes for myself. And of course, usually it's enough for the next day for lunch. And it's perfect because I don't have to spend a lot of time making lunch when I'm walking Hans, my Weimaraner. When I'm walking him, I get back and I've got 15 minutes to go before I have to get back online. And sometimes it's, you know, webinars or calls. And so I don't have to spend that time cooking. But yes, I absolutely love to cook. I love making sauces. That's why I grow the basil for the basil pesto. And, you know, I really am in tune to making, you know, my own tomato sauces and things like that. So this is my favorite time of year when the fruits and vegetables taste really good.
As an Italian, this is very much music to my ears. So I hope one day I get to taste some of your cooking.
Gravy, as they say, a mean gravy for pasta.
Yes. Yep. Is there anything that you're really proud of that your firm has been doing? You mentioned, I think it's terrific, the resource center of in terms of like helping small businesses and doing the work as a volunteer basis. I think there's so much that firms could learn from and different. So I commend your firm for doing that. That's terrific. Is there anything else you're especially proud of that your team has done or the lawyers have done over the, you know, since the COVID outbreak?
Well, yeah, Stefanie, you know, let's face it, you know, when folks aren't sure about when it's going to end, when folks aren't sure about a finite date to return to work, everybody's nervous. Everybody's, you alluded to that earlier. Everybody's worried about their jobs and efficient, you know, am I being efficient enough? Am I being productive enough? So one of the things I'm very proud of, one of many things I'm proud of about the firm is we are doing everything we can to keep the morale high. My chair, Brian Jackson, he has regular meetings with the entire firm and it is fantastic.
By go-to web or something. So, yeah.
And it is great. We get a chance to hear from the leader what's going on, what are the plans directly from him. So the gossip or the worrying and the fretting and the waste of productive time wondering and opining, that's out the window because we're hearing directly from our boss. That's one good thing. The other thing is every Friday we have a different theme. Last week it was show off your favorite fancy jeans, and our graphic designer put together a collage and then he sent it out to everybody. We don't push it out on social media, but we do it internally, handle it internally. The week before that is show us your favorite fancy pair of socks, because everybody's wearing socks, you know, instead of shoes, as we talked about earlier.
Yeah.
Collage together of people in these cool socks with, I have Weimaraners on my socks, and you know, people had flags and, you know, all kinds of designs, as you know, and it was just something to keep people laughing. Now this, what somebody suggested, one of our management committee members suggested that we send in our pictures of us with our masks on, and you know, guess who's behind the mask, because all you're going to see is the eyes and maybe a little bit of hair. So it's silly, it might be kind of, you know, corny, but we're doing things to let folks know that we're in this together and we're going to be McNees strong throughout the whole process and after we're back together again.
Yeah.
It means the world to all of us. I haven't heard anybody say, oh, this is so dumb. People are really happy to hear from each other and stay connected in any way that they can. And this is really helping.
I love those ideas. And the thing is, you know, not everything is a social, you know, you guys know I love social media, but not everything is a social media post. And some things are, you know, you want, don't want to seem tone deaf, and there's certain things that are appropriate to post internally that are not appropriate to post externally. So I love that. So I want to invite Rob back, and we're going to do our coffee cup reveal. I'm actually going to shut this light off. It's very, God, it's about to, there's a storm outside in New York. I know Rob said he just had it, but it is so, the lighting is so bad, and it's like all very dark outside. So I look like the Crypt Keeper from Tales from the Crypt right now. So with my lighting, so I apologize. Iris, would you like to show us your mug? And of course, like, Rob's lighting is perfect because that's what he does for a living. And I look literally purple on screen.
And you know, it may be, we've all heard these, and there's so many variations of keeping.
Oh, I love those. Yeah.
I thought it was quite appropriate. Number one, it holds a lot of coffee, and everybody knows I adore my coffee. And it's also the truth. Let's keep calm and carry on. We will do our best until we can do better.
Cheers to that. I love that. So my mug today is yet another. I have yet to repeat a mug, just so you know. And we've filmed now, what, 21 days,
Rob? Today's our 20th.
Oh, it's our 20th episode. Thank you. So this is a mug that someone gave me for Christmas this year. It's a French bulldog wearing earmuffs. I have a Frenchie. Yesterday, I had another Frenchie mug. I have a lot of Frenchie mugs. And Iris, Rob keeps saying, where are these mugs coming from? Because I live in a one-bedroom apartment in New York City. So, Rob, tell us about yours.
Well, before you go on, how many mugs do you have?
I don't even know, Iris. I think so. That's why I got that double wide shelf thing, so that I'm going to put mugs on the top and bottom. I'll count and I'll post a photo of my mugs. Okay. Rob is sneaking. That's not a mug, Rob. That is a camera lens.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, my God. What?
Gosh.
Okay. That's cool.
Clever.
Very clever. You fooled me. So we just want to thank you, Iris, for being here. We want to thank everyone keeping us safe. I want to thank, you know, the journalists and the healthcare providers and the folks stocking our shelves and everybody out there who's, you know, trying to make it work in a time where there's so much uncertainty. So especially moms, the working moms who it's hard enough to manage my life and my dog. I can't imagine if I threw a couple kids in there. So I give them all so much credit. Is there anyone you want to thank?
Well, you know what? I am just very thankful for my congregation. You know, we have Zoom services.
Oh, you do? That's awesome.
And I'm Episcopalian, so we keep them short. But I got to tell you, really, really powerful. And it really helps, because sometimes it's those days when not even a glass of wine with dinner is going to help. You got to have something to hold on to and to just remember that there is a higher power, you know. And for some of you out there, it may not be relevant, but for me, it really makes a difference. So I want to thank all the ministers, the pastors, the priests, the rabbis, the imams who are helping people keep the faith and stay steady on this path, because we will get to the other side. This will end. And we will be better for it, because now we're going to assess what's really important to us, what's really and what really doesn't matter. So it's so
effective. Yeah, it's great. And I would say, like, don't be tone deaf. Keep the faith. Those are some of the big things I took away from this. And it's so helpful. And put on makeup and your shoes. We got to also make sure our shoes fit, right? And put on that jacket. You know, today I'm actually dressed up compared to how I've been lately, because I did a webinar earlier today, and I actually do feel, it makes a difference, you know? I'll say, I don't know, Rob, if it makes a difference for you putting on a button down versus a hoodie.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
I work from home anyway, so that's, I'm sort of used to the hoodie thing.
Used to it. Iris, we want to thank you so much for taking the time to be here with us. And
thanks, Iris. Great to see you.
Thank you both.
And cheers, guys. Have a great day. Thank you.
Tomorrow's guest?
Oh, tomorrow's guest is Mike Meller from Prior Cashman, the CMBDO or something like that, chief marketing officer. But he will be with us. He was supposed to be here last week, but enormous thunderstorm happened and a gutter went down in his neighborhood, and it was tornado conditions. So we let him off the hook. So he'll be here tomorrow.
See everybody tomorrow.